These people have an agenda. Is it satanic? Yes. Do they want a world government? Yes. Are they willing to kill for it? Yes. Have they killed for it? Yes.
They're not happy with controlling people's bodies, but they want their very soul. And more than that, they want Satan's representative on earth, the Antichrist, to be master.
The final book of the Bible, the book of Revelation, says the Antichrist will come among us. It doesn't tell us when or in what form, but according to some evangelical Christians, Satan's minions are already here, creating havoc in everything from rock music and education to art and government.
We're trying to warn the world that there is a very corrupt, debauched, depraved group of men whose goal is to bring in the great unified world kingdom under their hellish master, Lucifer.
They believe in their Lord, Lucifer. They expect to have a satanic society. There's no question about that.
The Bible says that in the last days there will be 10 world rulers. These 10 men will be of one mind. They will give all of their strength unto the beast. 666.
Oddly enough, one group who regard this particular satanic conspiracy with some contempt is the Church of Satan.
Certainly the world is not ruled by a group of men who are trying to pave the way for the Antichrist. The powerful men in the world are always de facto Satanists because they're the people who understand how power functions and how the human animal functions. Their goal is not for some mythical Antichrist, it's simply for their own profit. And that's always been the rule since time began.
The Satanists say they don't worship a devil or an Antichrist, merely the carnal human with all his deep, dark desires. They reject the notion that they are the instruments of evil. As they see it, far more worrying is the power-hungry nature of fundamentalist Christians, whom they believe have concocted the whole satanic conspiracy for their own agenda of world domination.
Christ is the answer!
The devil. And don't tell me they ain't one. You can look around and see him everywhere.
Christ is the answer! Yes, he is the answer to the world's ills today!
Christianity in the past was linked to the state power. They did have the ability to kill anyone who was a heretic. I think that many Christian groups today would like to regain that power and crush anyone who opposes them.
They are obviously acting in concert because they have certain goals and aims which they wish to put over culturally on the citizens of the United States. They would like to control the government. They would like to control the school systems. They would like to put their sort of autocratic religious beliefs over on people who have no wish or no desire to have them.
But isn't Christianity a religion of love and forgiveness?
I don't believe there's a conspiracy of Christians trying to take over the world and force everybody to become a Christian. There are some Christians who do hope and pray that through political means they will be able to instill more Christian-type values within society. That's certainly a far cry from trying to take over the world.
Christ is the answer! Yes, he is the answer to the world's ills today!
However, such are the levels of mutual distrust and suspicion that conspiracy theories flourish on both sides. On the one hand, the evangelists accuse the Satanists of seeking world domination. On the other, Satanists claim the evangelists want everything their own way.
Let all witchcraft, sorcery, fly from hence.
The battle is akin to an exorcism, each seeking to eliminate the other. But in reality, both sides need the other to survive.
Deliver him, O Lord. By thine availing mercy, he may be freed and liberated from all sin.
According to the Satanists, in their search for world domination, evangelists have used occult manifestations to frighten people.
I think the wave of hysteria about some sort of national satanic conspiracy started with a TV show done by the reporter Geraldo Rivera. He claimed to have documented vast instances of child abuse and kidnapping and ritual abuse and baby eating and all this crazy stuff.
In 1984, this belief in a satanic conspiracy was triggered when rumors of satanic child abuse emerged from a nursery school in Southern California. Claims of a network of tunnels beneath the school where satanic rituals were performed sent shockwaves across America. A court case later said the teachers were innocent of all charges, but the thought had been planted in many minds.
There's, you know, no legal proof that they did any of these things, but you know, among the conspiracy theorists, there's this belief that they were in a satanic cult and they were committing ritual abuse of kids. That helped spur the big national satanic conspiracy theory. And it led to this almost cottage industry in experts on Satanism.
As half-truth, gossip, and rumor spread, the hysteria began to grow and the stories became more fantastical.
They used stun guns on children. I saw children with shock collars put on, so if they disobeyed their trainer, they were instantly shocked. As a child myself, I remember a night march. I fell down in the mud crying. And my mother came over in her military boots and kicked me and said, "Get up. You will get up. You won't stop." I saw children drugged, hypnotized. I saw them strapped to tables. I saw children buried alive and told if they ever told again that they would be buried forever.
It seems inconceivable that such atrocities could exist without people knowing about them. The reason Farley gives for no record of any investigation is that the police, teachers, government officials, and social workers were all members of the cult. However, for those who've explored how hysteria spreads through society, this is just an indication of how victims back up their claims without having to provide solid evidence.
A conspiracy theory is, in a sense, a self-fulfilling narrative. Once you start to tell it, in order to explain why there's no evidence, you have to keep expanding it. Somebody is destroying the evidence. It's in the interests of mysterious, powerful people that you can't identify, but somebody higher up doesn't want it to be known. That's why you can't prove it.
However, those making the claims say their biggest obstacle is persuading other people to believe them.
Society's denial is also one of the greatest help to these groups because your average person does not want to believe that these things happen. We don't want to hear about horror. We don't want to hear about abuse. We don't want to hear about ugly things. And often, the average person will turn their eyes away from these things. It's almost as if we believe if we don't see it, it doesn't exist.
Something has happened to these people. I don't think they're all crazy. I don't think they're all lying. I don't think they're all in it for the money. I think something has happened. The question is what?
Whatever happens nowadays, it can provoke an hysterical response all around the world.
Now we have global communication. We have television. We have the internet. We have mobile phones. And if something happens in one region of the world, however tiny, however remote, instantaneously, it spreads all over the world. So the stories of panics, conspiracy theories, rumors, which might have taken years to circulate, now are instantaneous.
And while the United States was tied up with its satanic panic, the hysteria crossed to the UK.
Ritualized abuse of children by devil worshippers.
Ritualistic abuse.
Allegations of satanic ritual abuse.
Children on a Rochdale housing
17
estate.
17 children
have now been removed.
Taken from their parents.
Ritual abuse on Orkney.
A network of satanic followers.
Tunnels beneath this cemetery.
And Satanism.
Satanic abuse.
During the 80s and ending pretty much by the mid-90s, there was something we call the Satanic Panic. And it was a time when fundamentalist Christianity was promoting the idea that Satanists had infiltrated the culture and were kidnapping women and breeding babies for sacrifice.
The material that was used in order to start the hysteria in the UK all used material which was sent to them, communicated to them from contacts in the US within the right-wing fundamentalist camp.
The stories began with sexual material, that they were being sexually abused, that they were being raped, that they were being fondled. Then religious imagery came in, that crucifixes were used to molest them, that they were witnessing infant sacrifices.
The government subsequently found no evidence of satanic child abuse. But as events in the UK and the US showed, the satanic conspiracies caused actual trauma to the people caught up in the frenzy.
This was serious primary damage that was done to family situations, children taken away from their families, child care workers and parents being imprisoned. Many of those cases have now been overturned in the courts. Nonetheless, that is irreversible damage.
Long regarded as the devil's work, rock music sends shivers down the spines of all good fundamentalist Christians who set out to combat its supposedly satanic influence. The Parents Music Resource Center was set up in the US to draw attention to what they regard as Satan's lyrics and images on CDs.
They got together in councils which were almost literally war councils to plan and plot how to take the United States back from what they felt was a conspiracy in the other direction. Because they felt so vividly that they were fighting a conspiracy, they became a conspiracy of almost a military scale.
Your music, rock and roll, is a satanic music. You make the music go black and you hear Satan speak.
The people behind the PMRC were mostly Washington wives, Republican and Democrat, including Tipper Gore, wife of Al. Also joining the crusade were the fundamental Christians of America.
I want to see music that advocates a kid kill themselves. Banned. I want to see music that says you go out and kill your parents. Banned.
In New York State, Pastor Brothers has taken this one step further. He's founded the Freedom Village, an institute designed to wean impressionable youngsters off guitar riffs and suggestive lyrics.
We have been called deprogrammers of young people. Well, at first I didn't like that term. The more I got to thinking about it, the more I did like it, because I think somebody better start deprogramming these young people.
Not everyone is convinced that rock music will spawn armies of Satanists and sex slaves.
Music is to entertain people. It comes in all different shapes and sizes. I may not like it, you may not like it, but that doesn't mean you have to create a legislative climate that keeps that music from being available to the people who want to enjoy it. It is only music. There is no devil, and it's not going to hurt you.
But when claims of backward masking emerged, it seemed fundamentalist Christians finally had the proof they needed that the Antichrist was communicating through music.
Backmasking became part of the anti-rock satanic conspiracy theory in the early 80s. The idea was basically that satanic record executives would plant evil messages backwards on albums. The idea was that if you put a message backwards on a record, it would have some kind of satanic sorcerous power over the legion of susceptible fans, making them, for example, smoke drugs, rebel against their parents, or worst of all, possibly turn homosexual. It first reached the media as a high-profile issue with the attempt to prosecute a British heavy metal band called Judas Priest.
The band were accused of subliminally embedding the words "do it, do it, do it" in their album Stained Class, which the prosecution alleged provoked a suicide pact between 20-year-old James Vance and 18-year-old Raymond Belknap in Reno, Nevada in 1985.
This case is about mind control, the manipulation of the minds of consumers for the objective of making money.
It's interesting, though, they didn't specify do what, do your homework, I don't know.
Is there anything there that could be considered a subliminal message?
Even though Judas Priest were acquitted of all charges, the question of subliminal messages remained on the agenda.
The strongest argument that backmasking doesn't work is the fact that if it did, you can guarantee the church and state would have been using it for centuries.
I think the hysteria over the supposed link between, you know, the supposed Satanism in rock music has in fact spurred on a lot of rock groups to become more and more quote-unquote satanic. It's a great marketing tool. It's a great symbol of rebellion. So, you know, is there some sort of sinister conspiracy behind it? No. I think that, you know, it's something that's created by the people who fear it.
But from the Beatles to the Beastie Boys, few bands escaped the accusation that they were working hand in hand with Satan.
The PMRC said that AC/DC stands for Antichrist Devil's Children. Now, if you had told that to the members of AC/DC, with whom I worked extensively, they would have fallen off their chairs laughing.
I've always studied the lyrics, And I found that only people deeply into Satan worship and occultism would write these things.
They also made astonishing claims about KISS's name. They said KISS stands for Knights in Service to Satan.
And where would Satanism be without Ozzy?
I don't think Ozzy Osbourne is a Satanist. I mean, he's a showman. And this is what a lot of people don't understand.
Most notoriously, he's supposed to have bitten the head off a bat. Though if he gained any black magical powers from that, they were probably outweighed by the fact he then had to have rabies jabs.
You look at their albums, someone put those symbols there. Someone had those incredible images. Someone gave them the words.
And the bete noire of almost every American parent, Marilyn Manson.
It was amazing to see the Christian picketers at the Marilyn Manson concerts who were so, you know, worried about, you know, let's face it, a rock star.
The kids, they're not interested in the old staid stuff. Now they want to get deeper. They've been desensitized by music, by television, and popular culture into the most horrible, filthy depredations. Absolutely, this is bringing people into such a mindset that the Antichrist will walk in with ease. He's got his whole substructure. The infrastructure has been prepared for the coming on the stage of the Antichrist, ultimate evil.
So, if or when he comes, how will we actually recognize him?
I believe he could come as a man of great statesmanlike appearance. Will he be a world leader? He may. Will he be a religious leader? Possibly. But certainly he will be a man that people will trust.
Prince Charles has been put up as a possible candidate for the Antichrist. You know, I don't think so. I think he's a little bit too goofy to be the Antichrist myself.
George Bush.
Henry Kissinger.
Bill Gates.
I've heard also that it's a 27-year-old American living in the Southwest.
Which narrows it down to about 30 million. Of course, all good things come to an end, including the world. And the return of the Antichrist has generated no shortage of prophesizers diligently on hand to warn of imminent disaster.
I cannot count how many Christian doomsayers there are in American society at this point in time. It is a very, very big thing to teach that the Antichrist is soon going to rise, that the end of the world is just around the corner.
There's always been people and groups who, whether it's based on the Bible or some other text or belief, believe that the end of the world is about to happen, or that there's some secret group that's trying to bring about the end of the world for their own sinister purposes, or the end of civilization anyway. So really, apocalyptic ideas and conspiracy theories are very closely tied together.
If the book of Revelation is to be believed, the end of the world will be quite an event.
There will be the four horsemen of the apocalypse, each one bringing greater terror than the one before. The pale horseman is, I think, the most terrifying because he brings with him death.
The belief that the world's about to come to an end has always been very popular, and I don't know if I'd say there's the people who are espousing these beliefs are in it for the money. Maybe some are. It makes a good story, makes good movies like The Omen.
But perhaps it's not the end of the world we should be worrying about. Rather, the conspiracy theories that generate the fears and distrust in society and the people who use them to justify their existence.
There have always been moments where certain things in culture have caused people to be very tense about their lives. This is when they have looked for a conspiracy theory to explain everything. And what's happened is that sometimes people have used the conspiracy theories to go after various different groups of people. Jews, blacks, Catholics, Satanists, even Christians. And so it's something that can be very dangerous.
No matter how much you question a conspiracy theory, once it's become embedded in the belief system of a person or a cult story, they will find ways of rationalizing it. They simply expand the boundaries.
And far from dampening down the conspiracy theories, both the evangelists and the Satanists continue to add fuel to the fire, because it's in their interest to do so. Without an enemy to fight, there's little meaning to their existence.
The game is about over. Because of all the events of the Bible, there are only a few events that are left to occur, but those events are so dramatic that I literally almost cry to consider the horrible gravity of the things that are going to occur.
Are Satanists conspiring to take over the world and influence the culture? Some might say that. I think that the human future will be directed by many Satanists, although the general culture may never know that they've had their hands on these things.
These people have an agenda. Is it satanic? Yes. Do they create wars? Yes. To bring about peace. And that peace is deadly. Because that's going to require all of us to surrender everything we've got to this evilarchy, this oligarchy of evil, for all time.